All right. Good morning. Good morning, YouTube land, and good morning here at the church. And as Pastor Todd was saying here just a little bit ago, wow, what a wonderful, awesome week and busy week. Lots of family, lots of things going on. But a week in which our attention, our focus, was on Jesus, and hopefully it was. And we're going to carry that through here today, this morning, and we're going to just praise God. We're going to worship God, give God all of our love, our adoration, everything. He deserves that. He deserves it every day, not just on one day a week, but every single day. We should. It should be like it's his birthday. And so anyway, let's pray and get started. So, Father God, we just come before you, Lord, right now, and we just love you, Lord. We just thank you. We praise you. We are excited, Lord, inside in our spirit, man. We're just excited, and we look forward, Lord, to what you're going to do. We know it's going to be good, Lord, because you're good, and you have good plans for us. So, Lord, we thank you. Just be with us here this entire service. We just actually have an expectancy, Lord. We're just believing that you are going to touch us. You're going to be even a tangible just presence that, Lord, you're going to be with us, and we're going to feel your presence. Know that you're with us here, touching our hearts, our minds, our bodies, and giving us everything that we need as we praise you, as we sing to you, and we worship you. And we say and ask and believe all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Stand if you're able, if you're willing to worship this morning. Let's get those clapping hands warmed up. Who's ready to clap this morning? Okay, so there you go. That's clap. Now, let's see if we can clap this out. Keep going. Keep going.
Thank you.
is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come, let's do that again.
Of mercy. God.
Amen. If you know it's true, clap, everybody. Thank you, God. You may be seated.
Good job, brothers. Good job, everyone. Well, that certainly was a blessing to be able to just take a load off, as Pastor Todd said, and just worship the Lord, come back together. And we've all been through some stuff this week, and it's been fun. There's been a lot of presence. The question is, did we find any time to be in the presence of Jesus? Because that's what that was all about. I know we haven't had Bible assignments here for the last couple weeks because of the Christmas season, but how many chose to read something in their Bible anyway? You guys out there on YouTube land, welcome. I see your hands too. That's an awesome thing. I think it's working. They say it takes 30 days to establish a good habit, and we've been at it a while, so give yourselves a hand in here and out there in YouTube land for reading your Bibles. God always has something good, and like Pastor Todd says, we are cheating ourselves when we don't read the Word of God. My wife and I were going through some instructions this morning. I'm one of those men that just absolutely refuses to read the directions till I can't figure it out, and I'm not mechanical. You can ask Pastor Todd. So, how are we going to put this zip line up? She's like, read the directions. I'm like, eh. But there's one book that I will read, and that's these directions. And so, having said that, we did not get in an argument because I submitted and started reading the directions with her. It does work. So we're on the countdown to the new year. The Christmas countdown's over. We got, what, 4 days in a wake-up, as they say in the Corps, the military. And so I'm going to take a brief exit from my normal series, which was on how to handle conflict in a godly manner, and just, I felt like God wanted to say, how do we end this year? How do we put this past year in godly perspective and move on into the future that He has for all of us? So that's really what this sermon is about. I didn't really name it. If anybody can think of a good name, name it for yourself, but we're talking about moving out of the past year, okay, and all the stuff that's happened and moving into God's future for us in particular, right? Because we all got stuff we want to do, but I think we need to find out what does God want us to do, right? So that's the gist of it. I don't watch the news. I can't stand it. Pastor Todd and I are pretty much of the same mindset. But I do know that somewhere, I guess, in the last 30 or so days, we had an election, if you could call it that. I don't know what's going on with it. But this I do know. God is in control. And I think the question we as Christians need to be asking ourselves, other than, well, I wonder if it was fair, and wonder if they're ever going to figure out who really won it, and wonder who's really going to become the president. I think the question we need to ask ourselves really is, as Christians, do we really believe that God is involved in that? And that He has the outcome already in His hand, in His providence, regardless of what it looks like? Because remember, the Bible says what we see through our eyes is what? Temporal, it's temporary. But the things that God has for us are eternal. So whatever's going on in that wild camouflage thing called an election, I'm not worried about it because I know God is in control. How many know that?
Amen.
So let's go there. I think one of the most important things we need to see throughout our lives, probably, as we begin to reminisce over the past year, as well as the lives of those in the Bible, is God has always chosen, in a lot of cases, to do the unexpected, to bring about good in our lives. He did it for the Israelites. He's done it for everybody in the Bible, if you can remember all the stories from Vacation Bible School. God uses the unexpected, okay? We're about to read about one of the unexpected things that happened in the book of Daniel. So if you want to go ahead and turn there, the book of Daniel obviously is in the Old Testament. It's about midway through your Bible. Like I said before, I used to hate it when the pastor would go, okay, could we turn to Obadiah? And you're like, okay, is that between Haggai or... But anyway, it's about midway, somewhere in there, maybe a little bit past. And for those of you that don't do a lot of reading in the Old Testament, and I never did either. When I first got saved, I spent all my time in the New Testament because there is where God directed me, and I think I learned a lot about how to live life, you know, through the things that the Apostle Paul wrote us. He wrote a lot of instructional things, the instructions of how to live our life. And so I spent a lot of time, and I didn't spend a lot of time in the Old Testament. I think if you spend a lot of time in formal seminary, you probably spend a lot of time, you know, in the Old Testament learning the chronological things of the Bible and how the whole thing was set up from the beginning to the end, Genesis to Revelation. But I didn't do that. But now I've for some reason God has directed me to that, so I want to share that with you today. One thing we were going to learn is that that Daniel believed that God was in control of all things. We're going to learn that. And we're in, again, Daniel chapter 2. In a moment, we're going to go ahead and read that. What we need to know is Daniel did not fear man, and he did not fear his circumstances, but he trusted in the one true living God. And I think we need to follow suit like Daniel did. Stop looking at what's going on around us and look more at God, because he is the truth. Right? And it says that in the New Testament. We've heard it numerous times from Pastor Todd. He is the way, the truth, and the life. That's God. He can be that for you, for each one of us here in this place. Before we go any farther, let's go ahead and pray. Father, we thank you again for this day, for this time to celebrate, as we just have, the birth of Jesus, our Savior. We thank you for the free gift of salvation to us, and we know it wasn't free to you. It was costly. It was painful. But we praise you and we thank you for that, for the ability to have eternal life if we choose to accept it freely. Help us to receive this word here in this sanctuary and out there on YouTube land, whoever's hearing it. Hear it with our ears, receive it with our hearts, and become doers, not just hearers of the word, so that your will be done in our lives and you'll get the glory. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you're there, Daniel chapter 2, really quickly, what happened was Daniel and his countrymen were captured by the Babylonians and hauled off to serve under King Nebuchadnezzar. And early in that process, King Nebuchadnezzar had a wild dream. He had a dream that he couldn't understand, and he called all of his wise men. The Bible called them, what did he call them? Astrologers, magicians, sorcerers, Chaldeans. He called them in because he considered them wise men. He says, hey, I need you people to interpret this dream. I need to know what that meant. If you know the story, they, of course, could not. They didn't have a clue. They were like, I don't know. I think we need to figure out why they didn't know. If you go quickly to chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, the gist of those two verses is, I'll read it real quick. The Chaldeans answered before the king. This is Daniel chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. They went before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth who can show the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, or ruler that asks such things at any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. Verse 11, and it is a rare thing that the king requireth. There is none other except the gods, they're referring to their gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. What we need to see here is, it was like they were almost accusing the king, hey, why are you even doing that? Nobody should even ask us that. That's ridiculous. That's a stupid question, almost, is what they're trying to say. They said, only the gods can answer that. But the more important thing that we miss is, and we're going to see it here in a minute when I read the whole text, is what did they not do with respect to the gods, their gods that they call gods. So let's begin the reading. One other thing, as soon as this happened, King Nebuchadnezzar said, okay, you people, I'm mad at you, you're all sentenced to death. Because you can't interpret my dream. Wow, I mean, that's crazy. But what else happened that was unexpected? For some wild reason, he lumped Daniel and his three friends into that same group of people who could not interpret the dream. And they hadn't even been asked to do it yet, as you'll soon find out. Yet the king said, you guys are going to get killed too. Daniel, could you imagine that? Could you imagine if somebody said, hey, these guys are all guilty. They've found guilty by a court of law. And just because you're here, you're guilty too. You get the same thing. Would that be unexpected? What would we do? Pardon me?
Foul.
Exactly. Call foul. I don't know what you're talking about. But that's what happened. So let's pick up the reading. So let's just understand that once that happened, he said, you're all dead. You're all going to die. This horrific death. First thing Daniel did was he ran to an audience with the king. He said, give me some time so that I can figure out what to do with your dream, in layman's terms. And then we're going to pick up in verse 17 and read down a little bit to find out what exactly Daniel and his friends did. To respond to this, you're going to die. This horrific, ugly death because you can't interpret the dream. Go to verse 17. Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his three companions, who we later know more commonly as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were renamed by the prince of the eunuchs of Babylon because that's the name that he gave them. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That was more toward the first chapter. Anyway, he went to the house to pray with them. And this is what verse 18 says, that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. First thing they did was say, give me some time, king, we'll figure it out. And then they ran to God. They didn't run to the phone and call everybody else that they thought might have a master's degree in dreams, right? And psychology and all the rest. They went to God. That should be a clue for us. When we're facing something that's horrifically crazy and we don't know, I love Charles Stanley's quote, go to the throne, not the phone. Well, nowadays it's Facebook, but it's in your phone, right? So, first clue, go to God. That's what they did. We should mirror that action. We should learn from them and not reinvent the wheel. Got something going on in your life you can't figure out and it's crazy? Get on your knees and pray to God. I'm not saying that you can't find a Christian friend or maybe your accountability partner, get together and read scripture and pray. But the first thing we need to do is go, God, you got this. Help me. The old HMJ, help me Jesus, right? We can say that now because we live in the time of Jesus Christ in the day of grace, the New Testament, right? They didn't have Jesus back in that day. They had God. But we know now that God, you know, sent his son Jesus, and now he is our advocate. We can go to Jesus. So help me, Jesus. All right? The other thing I want you to notice real quickly, when we went to verse 10 and 11, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, these guys that supposedly were going to know what to do, they talked about their God, but what did they not do? I see nowhere in Scripture, and we're not going to read it today, where they actually tried to communicate with that God or their gods. There's nothing in the Bible that said that, oh, they prayed to their God. They just simply said, hey, it's out there with their gods and they're not of human flesh, almost inferring that there's no way we can communicate with them. We're not even going to try. So that was a completely different approach to the gods of their world that they, you know, supposedly revered. I don't know about you, but if somebody's going to sentence me to be cut to pieces and my house be turned into a dunghill, like it says in Daniel 2, chapter 2, verse 5, I don't think I'm going to be, you know, praying to somebody that I don't even think I can talk to, which is kind of what they're saying. We're so blessed that when we have problems, we know God is real, do we not? We know God is real. We've seen him work. We've seen him. I know every one of you who are sitting here that know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and out there in YouTube land, you have had an occasion where you have been able to see God at work in your life. Amen. You can look back and see that. You need to remember those times. We'll get to that a little later. So anyway, let's continue on. So they prayed. Verse 19, carrying on. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changeth the time and the seasons. Now get this. He removeth kings, and he setteth up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise, and knowledge to them that know understanding. Who do you think is in charge of this presidential debacle of an election? Who do you think allowed everything in this world to happen that has been good and bad over the years in terms of who was ruling what country? I mean, there's a guy who could possibly be, I could be related to him in North Korea. I don't know. I was born an orphan, or sent over here as an orphan. Maybe I'm related to the infamous Kim Jong-un. My Korean name was Kim Kushik. That's with a K, not a T, please. Let me enunciate that. We're in church, but no foul word fall out of our mouth, right? So I'm just saying, you know, God has always been in charge of whoever he has allowed to set up kingdoms. And he's done it for a reason, even if they were awful and terrible. How many can think of a ruler over the years that we've studied in history in school that was awful and terrible? I mean, Hitler, all of them. I mean, there's some really... Even Saddam Hussein in recent years, right? But God allowed it. And if we can look past the temporal and look back at it over the years, we'll probably soon be able to see, just like in your own personal lives, somehow God used that you know, ruler that was so terrible for his good purposes in life. Something unexpected coming from that was going to be good. Let's continue with the reading. Verse 22, He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and light dwelleth with him. So then Daniel praised God. I thank thee and praise thee. Verse 23, O thou God of my fathers, who hast given me wisdom and might, and hast made known unto me now what we desired of thee. He answered their prayer. He gave Daniel the interpretation of the dream so he could go to the king and hopefully not be cut to pieces and his home turned into a dunghill. That was going to be the punishment. For thou hast now made known unto me the king's matter. So then on through the script, we won't read all that. Basically, he goes back to the king and he says, this is what your dream meant. He interpreted the dream for the king. Now we're going to see what the end result of that was when Daniel first went to God in prayer. That was the first thing he did after he said, King, give me some time. I don't need to go call all my friends and get their counsel. I'm going to go pray with my friends, you know, two or three or more are gathered there in the midst of God, and we're going to find out what God has to say. And that's what they did. What was the result of that? If you skip over to the end of the chapter and start in verse 46, we'll see what happened because of their actions. Verse 46 of chapter 2 in the book of Daniel. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face and worshipped Daniel and commanded that they should offer an oblation and sweet odors to him. In other words, they were supposed to really consider him, you know, an awesome guy because he was able to do this. You know, give him his due praise. The king answered unto Daniel and said, Of a truth it is, meaning it is true, that your God is a God of gods. He's basically saying, he's the guy. Your God is the guy. He's above our gods. Said, is the God of gods and a Lord of kings. Remember God put in verse, I think 22, God removeth kings and he setteth up kings. He is the God of gods and a Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing that thou couldest reveal this secret, this dream. So therein lied the good that came out of all that crazy stuff because Daniel knew where to go. Immediately, go to God, right? When's the last time you had something wild happen in your life? You know, whatever. You can think of it in your own mind. Just think back and be honest with yourself and ask yourself the question, what was the first thing I did to deal with that circumstance? As Christians, the first thing we should do is just acknowledge God. He's there. Now, I'm not saying you just, you know, haphazardly, oh, well, we'll be. I guess I'll just ride this out, whatever God wants to have happen. Because we live in a time and place where we have things that God has provided for us. If it's a health issue, call your doctor. Say, here's what I'm experiencing. God appointed them too. Go to your pastor. Go call Pastor Todd. Text him, say, I need to pray. Something's going on, right? Point of this is, what Daniel did, we can do too. Why can we do that? We can do that. And the rest of these verses that I'm going to run by, you don't have to turn there if you do. But you might want to write them down if you don't already know them in your brain, in your memory. We can do that because even today, you know, centuries and centuries later after this happened, the Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, I am the Lord thy God, and I change not. He's still doing the stuff he did way back there, right? And therefore, the sons of Jacob, that's you and I, are included in that inheritance. We're in the lineage of that if you know the Lord Jesus Christ. They are not consumed. You will not be consumed because the Lord hasn't changed. It's highly likely that maybe you have. I know I do. We all oscillate. I mean, we're not heroes of faith every 24/7. We all have our moments where we're like, Sometimes you just get tired. Life's tough. Been working 60 hours in a week and everything in your house is breaking and you can't get a hold of a repairman and you're just tired. And maybe for a moment your faith is a little bit weak. But you can come back. You just have to surround yourself with people that are going to encourage you in the Word of God and direct you in the right set of instructions to get you back on track, right? My wife will be remembering that forever. So, read the directions! I'm not going to help you. No, my wife is very mechanical. And so is my daughter. I'm not. Screwdriver? Screw? What do you do? Anyway. God is awesome. I think the most unexpected change that we can all remember, we just celebrated, is the birth of Jesus Christ. These people in his day thought they were going to get some major warrior like King David in his days to come in there and overthrow the Roman Empire, and that's not what happened at all. God took an unexpected situation of sending a baby in the world to save this world. If you pop forward to Revelation, I think it's chapter 19, I'll go there real quick. Last book in the Bible, and talk about Lord of Lords, Revelation chapter 19, you can go there if you want. This is John on the island of Patmos when he was exiled there, and God showed him what the end of the world was going to be like. This is a glimpse of the God we serve, the Lord of Lords, that even King Nebuchadnezzar came to know through this experience with Daniel. Chapter 19 of Revelation, verse 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. How many of you need some faithful and true stuff in our life today? Because I guarantee you that CNN, NBC, and all them other guys, they are not faithful, and 99% of the time, they're probably not true. Right? God is. Amen. So he was called Faithful and True, and in his righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew except himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called, anybody want to guess? The Word of God. That's what the Bible says. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth upon the winepresses of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And the final verse, verse 16, and he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's who he is. That's who he is. That's who he is for all eternity. going to just close here with this. As you look back on this past year, remember the old adage, you can't change the past, right?
Right.
We cannot do that. 5 minutes ago, 20 minutes ago during worship, that's already happened. That was a great thing. Whatever happened during worship, which was great, good or bad, we can't change it. But one thing we can do is we can change our futures if we will be faithful and true to God when the hard times hit, or the good times. And if we will allow God to be in control of our life, allow God to be, in fact, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I know we all oscillate in that too. It's a very, very distracting world we live in. There's so many distractions that can get us off the, what's the Bible call it? The straight and narrow path. It's one of these. Oh, I gotta go downstream. No. Uh-oh, I need a new car. That's about $47,000, but I really can't afford it. But oh well, they said I could, so yeah, sign the papers, right? I mean, I could go on and on and on. We've all done it. But we can recover if we will allow God to re-steer us, right? To become the focus. And guess what? He'll take something that's really wild in your life, and everything that you probably are expecting to come out of it, if you've submitted truly in your heart to God, you will be amazed when you look back at what He did to bring you through it. And sometimes it's a little bit more bad stuff. It's like the parent says, don't do that because I know what's going to happen to you. God does that to us all the time, but do we listen? Sometimes. Sometimes I listen. Sometimes I'm like, but I really want to do that, right? Because our human flesh, Pastor Todd, this tent we live in called this chunk of meat. And Satan knows that. He knows what he can tempt you with. The old Flip Wilson thing in the 70s, well, the devil made me do it. Some of you probably don't even remember that. The devil doesn't make anybody do anything. All the devil does is go, here. He tempts you. You decide whether or not you're going to jump off the cliff and go for it. But even if you have, there is forgiveness in the grace of God. Pastor Tom, I'm going to ask you to come on up and close this out if you'd like. If there's anyone in here who has never received the Lord Jesus Christ today, like Pastor Todd said last week at our Christmas service, today is the day of salvation. That's what the Bible says. If there's anyone that needs that, I would invite you to come up now. Come up now, come up when we're done. Pastor Todd and I will pray with you. We will make that happen for you so that you can begin to take advantage of the unexpected good that God has for you in your life, no matter where you're at. If you're out there in YouTube land, you can text me, call me, whatever you... I don't do Facebook, but if you do that on Facebook, I will respond. My number is 250-7774. Same area code, 574. Text it, call me. I'll respond. Call the church. I think the website, right, Rachel, has getsolid.org. The number's already on there. 223-7654, is it? 224, my bad. Call us. We will respond as soon as possible. And we will get you saved, because that's where this whole thing starts, with you receiving Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So, thank you for your time this morning. I'm hoping that you got a little bit of encouragement to trust and obey God, and to know that He is faithful in some of the most unbelievable circumstances that people in the Bible have gone through, that we read about, and that you in your life has probably been through this past year. You're going through it right now. You may have to carry it into the new year, but God will be there with you if you've received Jesus Christ as your Savior. So Pastor Todd, if you could bless us and pray for us and close us out. Again, if you haven't received the Lord, please feel free to come up and we'll get her done.
Give the Lord a hand, everybody.
Amen. Praise Jesus.
Thank you so much, Johnny. I really appreciate it. Gave me a little time off this week and didn't take time off from my Bible, but you know what? Preparing sermons is hard work. And if you've ever done it, you know it's true. So stand if you would. Let's dismiss. I thank everybody for their attention and time. I hope you had a Merry Christmas. I hope you're looking forward to an awesome 2021.
Yes.
If you didn't like 2020, then hopefully 2021 is going to be a little better for you. But if you don't have God in it, it's never going to be good. It doesn't matter if you have COVID in it or not.
That's right.
If you don't have God in it, it's not good. So keep that in mind. Next week's Bible reading is going to be open your Bible and let God lead you to the passage that He wants you to read. And when I ask next week if everyone read their Bible, raise your hand because God led you to that passage. Because that's what I'm going to do. I'm not exactly sure what I'm preaching, so I'm going to open my Bible. I'm going to say, God, lead me to the passage. Right? And so, please do that. Please read your Bible and don't cheat yourself.
Exactly.
Bow your heads. Let us pray and dismiss. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for time and place that we have each week to gather and to worship you and to look into your word and to receive from you and to feel the presence of your touch, yes. Father. Help the Holy Spirit to dwell in each one of us and just to in such a way that it overflows into our life and the decisions that we make and the interactions that we have and the reactions that we have. Father, help us to rely on you more and rely on self not quite as much. We pray that you make yourself real in each life in this place and on the internet, Father. Make yourself real now in a real and powerful way, an undeniable way. So, Father, right now I pray every spiritual blessing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ on the people who are watching, the people who are here. May your presence be so strong in their life that they can't deny you, Father. Bless them in every place they find themselves. Make your face to shine on them and give them peace. When they go out the doors, may you bless them. When they go in the doors where they're going, may you bless them, Father. And where they're at right now, make a blessing to the people around them, through them, as you're blessing them. In Jesus' name I pray. Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
This is the big goodbye.